attention.
So the title of my presentation is The Big Aha. And what this stands for, it's an acronym. It's how I want you to think about the future and how to future-proof your business. What it stands for is awareness, humility, and action. I'm going to walk you through these three principles. But the first thing, and I just want to echo Charles' thoughts, I'm really optimistic about the future. And let me just give you one big reason why. I'm actually going to do it on both hands, and so I want you to think about this. Could anyone tell me what the mathematical relationship between these numbers is? 1,000 million, billion, trillion. Each one is 1,000 times larger than the next. The reason I tell you this is there are an extraordinary number of technologies that are doubling, and many of them are going to double 10 times in the coming decade. But if something doubles 10 times, it's not 10 times as large, it is 1,000 times as large. We go to 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256, 512, 1,024. What that means is if we're in a technology today and it's in the thousands but it's doubling, we're going to be in the millions in a decade's time. If we're in the millions today but it's doubling, we're going to be in the billions. Each one is a quantitative leap ahead. And now let me walk you through at least 10 trends that are going to transform the world and make it a decidedly better place. And these are in no particular order, but the first trend I want to tell you about is wearable technology. Really, it's only a couple of years old. The Apple Watch just came out 6 months ago. It's going to transform the retail experience. It's going to transform banking. Many of you are already wearing a Fitbit, a Fuel Band, or Jawbone. Could I just see how many of you already wear a device?
By the way, this was done two years ago. So it looks like about 10%.
But has it ever occurred to you, well, what might the Fitbit 2.0 of the near future look like? We know it's coming. We just don't know exactly when. Well, here's one idea. So I don't know if that is creepy, cool, or a coming sign of the apocalypse. But here's the transition you're living through, we're living through, and I don't think most people appreciate it. You and I grew up in a world where we first went to the internet through our desktop computer. Now we're going to the internet through our smartphone. In the not too distant future, the internet and its information is going to come directly to us. And this is going to transform the world in some profound ways. How many of you know what this technology is? Can I see a show of hands? Handful of you do. It's called Oculus Rift. Here's a short thing that you need to know about it. It's 24 months ago, the idea for this technology and the virtual reality goggles was just an idea in a teenager's head. A couple of months ago, Facebook bought that company for $2 billion. And why did they buy virtual reality goggles? It's not just because they saw an opportunity to transform gaming and education. They see an implication that's going to affect your industry. Here's what Facebook really might want to do with Oculus Rift. This is a mall of the future. So will all of us shop that way? No, not all of us will, but there are some people who might. And what you have to understand is this technology is just going to get better, faster, and more affordable. And maybe one of the really big demographics who will be utilizing this technology are seniors who are no longer as mobile. But might that have some implication on the number of malls that we have in the future? Yeah, it's a possibility. Here's another trend I want to tell you about. How many of you are familiar with 3D printing, additive manufacturing? This is the physical printing out of objects. It might interest you to know that General Electric has already printed all of the operational components for a jet aircraft engine. All of these parts are 3D printed. And they have said by 2017, so just 2 years, they're going to be printing aircraft engine parts. Now, what is the implication to your industry? Well, think about this. What does it mean for the global supply chain when, in the near future, instead of printing or producing and manufacturing very sophisticated objects over in Asia and over in Europe, putting them on ships, transporting them across oceans, bringing them into ports, putting them on trucks, delivering them to warehouses, in the not too distant future, we're going to be printing very sophisticated objects right in your backyard. What are the implications of that? It's a trend that you need to be aware of. And to just show you how fast this trend is moving, here's what they're doing over in China.
Well, since COVID, they can go back to 10 houses in just one day. Companies have been
printing home since February and says customers can also order custom-made homes.
Printing homes. This is where we are today. If that trend undergoes a thousandfold increase, where might we be in the near future? And if you don't think this trend is coming fast, just a couple of weeks ago over in Italy, this is the world's largest 3D printer. Two stories tall. Their hope is to build affordable housing for poor people all across the developing world. Will this come to fruition? I don't know for certain, but the potential with exponential growth suggests that it is a real possibility. The third trend I want to introduce you to is advances in nanotechnology. If any of you have the new Samsung phone, it has a new self-healing nanomaterial in it. And here's what your phone can already do today.
In their video, they scratch the phone up and down on the back next to a regular backing. Then after 2 minutes of sitting, the G-Flex actually completely heals, almost, while the regular phone is, of course, still scratched. Now,
self-healing materials are a reality. A couple of years ago, nano-enhanced products were a $100 million a year global industry. Today, in 2015, it's about a $10 billion a year global industry. By 2020, it's expected to be a $100 billion a year global industry. From 100 million to 100 billion, that's a thousandfold increase. But what else are we doing, and how might this trend affect your industry? Well, we're now working on self-healing concrete. We're just at the early stages, but if this trend undergoes a thousandfold increase, what does that mean for your industry? And here's another material that's just being developed not too far from here at Stanford University. It's a new nanomaterial. It's called passive radiative cooling, and the material actually, with no air conditioning, lowers the temperature inside a building by 5 degrees Celsius. So is that a material that some of you might need to be aware of? Might it reduce your energy consumption in the near future? Might it impact or lessen the amount of carbon we're emitting into the atmosphere? Absolutely. Just another reason why I'm optimistic about the future. Trend number four, another thousandfold increase. Only this time we're starting from a base of tens of thousands, but we're going to go millions. This is the robotics revolution. Of course, drones are already here, but let me just show you this little clip. What I like about that clip is just to show you how safe drones are getting. Could I see a show of hands? How many of you are already using drones on your construction sites? Could I just see a show of hands? So it looks like 5%. But might that number increase to 10, 20, 40, 80% in the near future? Absolutely. If you're not thinking about how to employ drone technology in your facilities today, you might already be behind the curve. But how many of you know this? Self-driven robotic cars are already legal here in the state of California. How many knew that? Well, that's a fact. But let me show you what they're doing over in Gothenburg, Sweden with self-driven autonomous cars.
Cars, we have the objective in 2017 to actually bring 100 self-driving cars to our customers on real roads here in Gothenburg.
100 self-driven cars in a couple of years, maybe 200 the year after that, 400, then suddenly a thousandfold increase. And if you don't think this trend is coming fast, how many of you saw just last week that Elon Musk, the CEO of Tesla, announced that his Teslas are going to have an autonomous driving capability within the next 3 years? But if you think about how Uber has transformed transportation in urban areas like San Francisco, what is the future of urban areas in a world of self-driven autonomous vehicles going to look like? Well, these are the types of things that you need to be aware of and you need to be thinking about sooner rather than later. The sixth trend you need to be aware of, another thousandfold increase. Only this time we're going from millions to billions, and this is the number of computer chips, sensor technology we're putting on physical objects. We're going to go from hundreds of millions today to an estimated 50 billion by 2020. To help you understand why this is so important, a couple of companies have done some reports on the economic opportunity here, and they're saying within the next decade, a super smart world is an economic opportunity of anywhere from $7 to $19 trillion business opportunity. And let me just show you a couple of these opportunities. The greatest one is smart buildings. This is Schneider Electric's headquarters over in Paris, France. A couple of years ago, they retrofitted with 10,000 sensors to make it a super smart building. Their goal was to reduce energy consumption in that building by 80% by the year 2020. Well, they implemented the project in 2012. By 2014, just last year, they had already reduced their energy consumption by 85%. The number of smart buildings that are expected to come online by 2020 estimated to grow 40-fold. So if you're not already thinking about how you make your buildings and facilities super smart in order to reduce energy consumption, you're already behind the curve. But this technology is just going to get better, faster, and more affordable. The seventh trend I want to tell you about, you might not think too much about this, but gene sequencing technology is getting better every 4 months. Here's what this means is, 8 years ago, this fellow, his name is Craig Venter, said, hey, I want to sequence my genome, and that's exactly what he did. But 8 years ago, it cost him $150 million to sequence his genome. Not very practical. But technology is getting better every 4 months, which means the corollary is the price is cut in half every 4 months. And if you cut $150 million in half starting in 2007, something remarkable happens. And here's what's going to happen. By the year 2020, it's going to be more expensive for you to flush your toilet than it is to sequence your genome. That is extraordinary. What cost $150 million 8 years ago is going to be pennies in the future? Yes, and this is going to have profound implications on human health and the pharmaceutical industry. But what's the implication to you? Well, I think one of the things we as a society have to do is start preparing for us living to 100, 110, and possibly 120. I suspect some of you are thinking to yourself, ooh, I don't want to live to 120. I'm going to suggest that living to 120 in the future is not going to be anything like living to 120 today. Our brains are going to be sharper, our knees are going to be stronger, our hips are going to be more flexible. The world is going to be a decidedly different place, but how are we going to house all of these individuals? And maybe they're going to have to begin working for a little bit longer. And what are the implications to your industry in this world that might be here before many of us are really ready for it? The eighth trend you need to be aware of, artificial intelligence, computer processing power. Here's how I want you to think about this. A couple of years ago, you might remember IBM put its supercomputer Watson on the game show Jeopardy. That computer was capable of 70 trillion calculations per second. To help you understand 70 trillion calculations per second, imagine you had a handheld calculator and you had to do 70 trillion calculations. Do you know how long it would take you to do that? Assuming you could work 365, 24/7? It would only take you 60 million years to do what that machine does in 1 second. The reason I tell you this is one of the reasons why people miss the future is they fail to appreciate even our tools are getting exponentially more powerful. How can we sequence the genome ever faster? Well, our tools are getting faster. How can we discover the next generation nanomaterial that's going to revolutionize the construction world? Well, we can simulate it on these tools. But of course, that's not the only thing we're using artificial intelligence for. 4 years ago, it was on a game show. Today, many people in the real estate industry have already hired Watson, and what they're doing is they're using Watson's cognitive power to help figure out where to locate buildings in the most efficient way. They understand demographics, they understand transportation, they understand labor and land costs, and they are helping your competitors make better decisions. So if you're not already thinking about how to employ this tool, again, you need to be aware of it and you might already be behind the curve. The ninth trend I want to tell you about, another thousandfold increase, is data storage. The amount of data we are collecting is growing exponentially. But here's how I want you to think about this and its implications to you. Here in San Francisco, Seattle, a handful of other areas, Amazon is now getting into the grocery delivery business. Do they really want to be in the grocery delivery business? I don't think so. They're in the data business. Every time you buy something, what you buy, when you buy it, how you want it delivered, when you want it delivered, they're learning a little bit more about you. And 2 years ago, they were on 60 Minutes, and their program to make deliveries with drone got a lot of press, but they said something far more interesting in that interview, and it didn't get a lot of coverage, but it's going to affect many of you in this room. Here's what they said. Here's their end goal. Here's what Amazon really wants to do.
Anything you want on Earth, you're going to get from us.
Anything you want on Earth, you're going to get from us.
That's where we're headed.
Anything on Earth, not just books, not just consumer items, anything on Earth. And they are now collecting so much data on their customers that their end goal is to know what you want to buy before you even know what you want to buy. And if you don't believe this, just a couple of months ago, they filed a patent for predictive shipping. They're going to start strategically placing objects in San Francisco, other cities, in the anticipation that you're going to buy them, and they're going to deliver it to you as quickly as possible. This is going to profoundly affect the retail, the transportation, and the delivery markets, and you need to understand the second and third order implications to your business, because this world is coming down upon all of us really fast. So all of this change, this gets to the H in the big aha. We need humility. Humility to the idea that what served us well yesterday might not be sufficient moving forward. And here's what I mean by humility. What I want you to do now is I want you to turn to the person next to you and answer for them this simple question. What two colors are the yield sign here in North America? Go ahead. Tell the person next to you what two colors are the yield sign.
What's the color of the yield sign? What is it?
All right, I already heard the answer. Those of you who said yellow and black, congratulations. That was the right answer up until 1971. The yield sign has been red and white for over 40 years, since Richard Nixon was in the White House. I'm sure some of you are going, no way, that's not true. But so what does this mean? Well, those of you who said yellow and black, let me just give you an idea of what your brain kind of looks like. Here's what your brain kind of looks like. The message that I want to deliver here is that, look, there are certain things that we learned early on about our industry that, like the yield sign, absolutely, they were correct years ago, but the world has changed, but our thinking has not. We all have to have humility to the idea that not everything that sits up here is still necessarily true. And so let me give you another example. If I were to ask you 5 years ago, what color is a taxi, what would many of you said? You would have said, well, they're yellow. Well, of course, they're not yellow anymore, are there? How many of you have already used Uber or know what Uber is? Let me see a show of hands. Yeah, well over half the room. This company has a valuation of $50 billion, and it is changing how people think about automobiles. No longer do they need to own an automobile, they just need to access an automobile. And they are moving to cities like San Francisco and Seattle that have a strong network of driver, so they never have to own an automobile in the first place. But of course, that's not the only thing that's going to be Uberized, is it? We're already figuring out how to Uberize office workspace. WeWork has a valuation of $10 billion. Trying to figure out how we use these new tools that we have today to make the best, most efficient use of all of our physical real estate holdings. But of course, it's not just enough to be aware of these change and to have humility. We have to take action. And let me give you one big action I think all of you need to take as leaders, is on a regular basis, take an entire week just to think about the future. I can already hear what some of you are thinking. You're thinking, who the hell do you think you are to tell me I have to take a week just to think? Don't you understand how busy I am? I do. But if a week is too much, break it down. Take an hour a week, take 12 minutes a day, just read, reflect on how your world is changing. Let me give you some trends that I think you should be thinking about. Here's one. This is North America's first truly net zero energy building. Just went live last year in Evanston, Illinois. Does the possibility exist for you to have a truly net zero energy building in the near future? I think it does. You need to be thinking about that. North America's first urban farm just went live in Newark, New Jersey, of all places. This might be a trend that grows exponentially. Maybe that's something that you need to be thinking about. Online education and how that's going to transform the universities of the future, something you need to be thinking about. Are we still going to be going to campuses with buildings? I suspect some of us still will, but not everyone. These trends are going to have direct implications to you, and you need to be thinking about them sooner rather than later. But let me just wrap up and say, here's how I want you to think about the future. I want all of you to picture a pond the size of this room. And let's say it's the first day of September. And on this pond, there's a perfectly sized lily pad on the first day of the month. It then doubles. So on the second, there are two. The next day, we go to four. Then we go to 8, 16, 32, 64. But then on the last day of September, the entire lily pad, or the entire pond is covered with lily pads. I now want you to think an answer to this question. On day 20, so two-thirds of the way through that percentage, or through that exercise, what percentage of the pond is already covered with lily pads? I want you to just think of an answer. Okay, my guess is very few of you said the answer is 1/10 of 1%. You're like, what? What do you mean? You just told me if something doubles 10 times, it's going to be 1,000 times bigger. Yes, I did. But here's how I want you to think about this. All of these trends I've been telling you about, they have in fact been doubling, but we're just at day 20. But if something doubles 10 additional times, how much bigger does it get? It gets 1,000 times bigger. So by day 25, we're just a little over 3%. Not till day 29 that we get over 50, but once we get over 50, boom, the whole thing is covered. I suspect some of you are saying to yourself, well, Mr. Future Man, if the world's changing as fast as you say it is, how come my world feels pretty much the same? My message to you is these trends have, in fact, been doubling. What you have to appreciate is we're just at day 20. The really big change is just ahead of us. That is the world we need to be aware of. This amount of change requires humility, and it demands action. Thank you very much.
Successful real estate people from all walks of life. And so why do we do this? Obviously, Dober doesn't write us a check for doing this. So we do it because, well, we feel we like the idea of giving back and helping you. And because we feel that you're the next leaders of our industry. I mean, whether you work for somebody and wind up being a top employer, as an employee, or you become an entrepreneur and you create your own businesses, hopefully we're providing you the tools to be successful at that. And you don't have to, not everybody in real estate is an entrepreneur. In fact, it's a very small percentage. Some professional managers are entrepreneurial managers. They're sort of like in the middle of the two. But for all intents and purposes, most of the people in the real estate industry work for someone or something. And it's a matter of what level you achieve and what level of power you achieve. You know, a number of years ago, when I retired, and I was doing consulting, I got a call from Disney, the Disney company. And they asked me if I would consider going up to Orlando to run take over their project called Celebration, which was a big community, a housing retail community created by the Disney people. And it wasn't doing well for a lot of reasons that we could spend hours talking about. So I went up there and they flew in some people from California and we chatted all day and we seemed to have some kind of synergy and so forth. And so far, towards the end of the day, I said, look, I have three questions that I got to ask you. And I have to know the answers to these three questions, and they have to be positive. Otherwise, I'm not interested. I said, because there's an old cliche about taking over bad projects. Taking over bad projects that have no hope is like being the captain of the Titanic and you're rearranging the deck chairs, because that's what it's like to be running a bad company, a bad business. So I knew that major changes had to take place in this community called Celebration. So I said to them, well, here's my questions. Do you have the financial resources to finish this project? Because look, we don't want to go to work for somebody that doesn't have any resources, doesn't have financial resources. I mean, you may not even get a paycheck in 2 weeks. Okay, I assume Disney had enough money to do this. And I said, do you have the commitment to spend the money? Are you willing to make the commitment to spend the money to finish this project? And they assured me that yes, that Michael Eisner, who was chairman of the board of Disney at the time, said is determined to finish this thing. I said, okay, but here's the third question, it's the most important. Are you going to give me the power and the authority to do what I have to do here to make this work? And they said, well, no, you would report to this five-man committee in Los Angeles, and, you know, and lunch with there, and I said, thank you for the lunch, thank you for the cappuccino, but I don't, at this time in my life, I don't take a job where I don't have the ability to be successful. And so I just went back to my consulting business. But I give you that as a just a little antidote thing, that when you get enough development in our industry, you must look after yourself. Don't just be mesmerized by something on the surface. You are entitled to ask those kind of questions when you go for employment. And if that company doesn't want to bother answering those kind of questions, you don't want to work for that company. You want to work for somebody or something that respects you and feels that you really want to be successful and you want to have the tools and the resources to be successful. Otherwise, don't waste your time. Don't stay in a job that you know you're going nowhere or the company's going nowhere. Get up in the morning and put your feet on the floor and say, damn, I like what I'm doing, and I can't wait till I go to work. I mean, the sad thing for a lot of people, and it's just the way life goes, they get up in the morning and they go, damn, I just don't want to go to work today. And so that's your responsibility. You have total control over that. And when we put these five letters after your name, after you all graduate here, you're going to have additional tools. Because remember, once you earn this degree, no one could ever take that away from you. You carry those letters with you the rest of your life, and you have them, and a lot of other people don't. So keep working hard. You heard in that presentation, I had an article, and I think it was sent to you. You probably didn't get a chance to read it. I thought it was one of the best articles recently I've read on 3D printing. And if you open it up, there is a animated or a video in the middle of it. Hopefully it all transferred when you got to the link, because I found that they had some blocks on the link and I had to figure out how to get around them. But you will actually see a 3D printer, making a 2,500 square foot two-story home. And you will actually see how the printer goes about doing that. And if you can do that, I'm telling you that we're not far away when they're gonna build 40-story office towers this way. And I have a bad knee. You saw me working a cane. I'm going to have surgery in a couple of weeks. I have to replace my knee. It's what happens when you live too long. But I'm going to a surgeon who I consider a 21st century surgeon, because he is really into technology. And he uses robots assisting him in the operating. Says that makes me almost perfect, because I asked the computer with the robot rods that go in to tell me if I have set the knee perfectly. He said, without this, it's artwork. That up till now, the surgeon is a good guy or a good gal, but they gotta kind of have to guess where exactly that knee should go so all the ligaments all work at the same time and everything's working. So it's just experience. With this technology, he assures me that this thing is like 99.9% accurate. He, on the side, runs a technology company. He's hired a whole bunch of young tech people, and they are creating more robotic tools for surgeons. And he says that within 5 or 10 years, most operations will be done entirely by robots, with the overseeing by a surgeon, because they will be more accurate and more perfect in what they do. Because, you know, I kind of kid around with him, and when I said, he said, robots don't have hangovers. They never get tired. They don't have arguments with their wife or spouse or friends and everything. So they're always in the same mental state. And so, you know, you can't count on a doctor being that way. But anyway, I hope you take the time to read this, because this talks about a lot of the things that are, this is 2 years old, you just saw. Already, what he said is archaic when you read this article. This is how fast it's coming at us. So in terms of 3D printers, and oh, by the way, he also said that 3D printers are going to start making human cells and embryos and parts of the body. So it's all going to happen in your lifetime. Okay, let's go back. Let's talk about this in terms of real estate. Well, let's talk about one other amazing thing that's coming in it. And it's here, and that's the autonomous automobile. And now we just touched on it here, and he says he was amazed that that person from Sweden said, we're going to have 100 cars in 2 years. We have thousands now. There's 100 running around the streets of Pittsburgh right now. I mean, within a few years, we're going to have tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of driverless cars. And I know that my granddaughters, who are younger than you and everything, they already told me they don't want to own a car. They don't think it's necessary. 25% of the people who live in downtown Miami don't even have a driver's license. So we're going into an era, a time now when people aren't going to own cars. It's going to be some passe thing that society used to do. We're moving on. So what does that mean for us in real estate? Well, guess what? We're not going to have to build car dealerships anymore. We're not going to have to build shopping centers with big parking lots. We're not going to have to build houses with garages. You want to say something?
Yeah, one of the other pastors, I believe, in land use regulations discussed about this. It's only been noticed within parking buildings where the vacancy rates of parking buildings.
They what?
The vacancy rates of park buildings in Miami has decreased a lot, where they're actually going bankrupt.
Yeah.
And with the advent of driverless cars, what are you going to do with parking buildings?
Well, of course.
Vacant. What are you going to do about the regulatory body regulating the amount of vehicles within multifamily buildings?
Well, that's great input. And I was just going to get there. So we're going to have all these changes to real estate structures. You have to be aware of this. You have to be at the forefront of this. Now, are you going to have all the answers? No. But what he tells you, what I'm telling you, think, overwhelm yourself with information, data, read what other people are doing, don't stop reading, don't stop being inquisitive. And when that guy comes, or a gal comes into your office with the Encyclopedia Britannica on a floppy disk and says, this is the future, whatever that person, pay attention to him or her. Because that might be the next great breakthrough that we're all looking for. And wouldn't it be great if you were at the front of that parade? So to be a leader has a responsibility of leading. There's a big difference between leadership and management. They're both critical. A leader leads, a manager manages. Most managers are great at what they do, but they don't have leadership skills. They don't have that spirit of visioning and so forth. Give them a plan and give them an objective and they're off to the races, and they'll build that building for you, or they'll run that building for you, and they'll do all those things. And they'll make a lot of money. But if you are a leader and an entrepreneur, you got to talk all these other people to come along with you. You got to sell the program. They got to buy in. Otherwise, they're not part of it. And guess what you got to do with those people that work for you? You got to treat them with a lot of respect. You treat them with a lot of respect, and you convince them that they are not the problem, but they are part of the solution. They will work their butts off for you, and it's not always only about money. People want to feel respected and that they're contributing. Only you as a leader can make them feel that way. You've got to set the table. You've got to set the environment for that positive production in your business, whatever it is. So whenever you get a chance and you think you're getting cocky or you're getting too wise-ass running a business or being a big manager, step out, go imagine, and you imagine standing in those other people's shoes and say, is it good for them? Is everything working? I mean, because I learned the hard way, like we all do, people like me who are successful running companies and everything, how important it was to hire people who were smarter than me. I mean, I worked so hard at hiring people who were smarter than me and knew more about things than me, because I wanted to lead, but I didn't want to do that stuff every day. I mean, I built thousands and thousands of homes. I mean, I was a pulpit president once. I hated home building. I mean, I hated actually being involved in home building. So I had these fabulous people that knew how to build houses and do it right. I loved running the company. I loved going out and buying the land and working with the architects and creating the marketing programs and so forth. That was way more important to me than building the house. But the guy who builds the house, well, the guy, now it's a lot of gals building houses. They're out there swinging hammers now too. They don't want to be the one running the company. They don't want to out and go out and buy land. Are you kidding? They're going to show up at the job at 7 o'clock. They're going to work to 3:30 and they're going to go home. I mean, that's the world they live in. So keep this concept of leadership an important thing. So we've got autonomous cars. So what is that going to happen to you guys? Well, you're going to be building things in the future that I built. You're not going to be building what I built. What I built is passé. Don't look in my rearview mirror for your future. Don't be frightened about this, because there's where opportunity lies. The failure is going to be the people who stick to the past, that live in the past. I mean, I have builders. I mean, I turn down consulting jobs. Why? Because they call me up and they talk to me and say, you know, we want to reinvigorate our business, and, you know, so we want to do this and that. And I say, okay, what are you doing to adjusting to what's coming? What are you doing to designs and everything? Oh, no, look, I got these great house plans. I've been building them for the last 10 years. I got my subcontractors all trained. I don't want to change anything. I just want to keep doing this. And I say, I can't help you, because the product you want to build is not what the market wants and what the market needs. Remember one thing about real estate. Almost any part of real estate boils down to marketing. Why do I say that? Because marketing, because what you're doing, whatever you're doing, if you're building, if you're managing and everything, you have recognized a need in the marketplace, and you're going out and filling that need. So if you build something that nobody needs, or nobody wants, or nobody, well, you know, it's like the old Field of Dreams, if I build it, they'll come. They don't come. So the challenge is to recognize what the real need in the marketplace is, whether it's in management, whether it's in construction, whether it's in development. Think, what's the need out there? What's going to be the need of my grandchildren who are 10 years away, but who are going to get there? What kind of housing are they going to need? What kind of shelter are they going to need? What environment are they going to want to work in, or are they going to have to work in? I want to be the builder that builds that. I'll tell you another great segment of the housing business, which I've told a lot of the classes here. People, students like you ask me, well, if you were my age today, where would you go in real estate? What segments would you aim at? Well, you know, I don't want to be too biased or prejudiced, but the point is, I think there's two great areas for you guys. And they cover a lot of area, but one, redevelopment. We're going to tear down everything we built in the next 50 years and rebuild them bigger, better, and faster. What you see when you drive down highways now, 20 years from now, 10 years from now, then those buildings aren't going to be standing. They're going to be replaced. Particularly in places like Broward County, Miami, and some parts of Miami-Dade, there's no more land. So you can't buy 100 acres in Broward County anymore. That doesn't exist. So where is all the activity in Broward County going to be? Places like Broward County. Tearing down and building better, and it's going to be—it's a great opportunity because you'd be taking an old archaic building and replacing it with an energy-free building, a clean building, a building that has a great NOI at the end of the day, and so on. And it's going to be better than what's there. By 2050, we're going to build the equivalent of 75% of all the houses that exist in the country today. We're going to double it, or almost double it, by 2050. That's how many housing and shelters we're going to need, just in the United States. So that's one area. The other area, anything at all to do with health and wellness. Because as the population gets older and bigger, of older people, we have extended life, but we haven't really necessarily extended perfect quality of life. Maybe medicine will make a breakthrough on that soon, and maybe we will have people living to 120 in a very healthy condition. But right now, we need hospitals. We need assisted living facilities. We need medical buildings. We need, you know, today, I mean, hospitals can't afford today to keep all of the equipment in the hospital, the CAT scan machines and all these different things. So we put them in separate buildings. So you're going to see campuses around hospitals get bigger and bigger and bigger. You're going to see the outreach of health services and everything growing like crazy. I mean, There's a community up in North Florida called the Villages. I don't know if anybody's heard of it. It's the largest retirement community in the world. There's 60,000 houses in it. There are 120,000 people live in the Villages. And it's age restricted. So the average age, median age in the Villages is younger, but it's about 64, 65 years old. What they can't build fast enough, because they're building 3,000 houses a year, but what they can't build fast enough is all the medical support buildings. They're actually, even though they're selling 3,000 houses a year and building 3,000, they could sell 5 or 6. But the reason is 7 or more. The reason why they can't is because people come in and say, oh, where's the nearest hospital? Where are the nearest doctors? Well, you got to drive about 10, 14 miles from here. People go, no, I want to be close to a hospital. I want to be close. So that becomes a big measuring point. So we're going to need a lot of real estate, not only to handle the growing population of older people, but also to replace all the not so efficient buildings in the health and wellness business that we want to replace. So I see those as two great areas that will have to go on regardless. Residential housing, multifamily housing, for sale, for rent, always going to be iffy, always. You'll be big boom years and people will make a lot of money, and then there'll be bad years, and that's the nature of our business. We are a risk-reward industry. I mean, if you don't like risk-reward, just figure you're going to settle in for a mediocre middle management job, because there's almost no place in this industry that I know of that you can't, that to hit a home run, you better take a chance. Okay, I got about 10 minutes, so I'll... wish I had more, but I'd open it up for you guys. I mean, I hope I've stirred some interest in you and some concern. And so if there's anything you want to discuss, you want me to elaborate on or anything, just let it shoot right now. Yep.
I just want to say thank you for getting your questions that you would bring up in the interview and the posture that we should have going into the
questions. Yeah, so don't lose that fact. That you have a right to ask the questions. It's very important. Anybody else? What do you think about autonomous cars?
Yeah, I really like the idea.
Yeah?
But recently, Tesla had a problem where one of their autonomous people, actually, the driver put it in autonomous mode, and he wound up losing his life because he didn't recognize the truck as a vehicle. I know, but with technology, usually, you know, when they build airplanes in the past, a lot of people died, but technology got better and better.
Sure.
So it's the same thing with the autonomous vehicle.
Well, I asked the president of FedEx, this is a true story, They asked the president of FedEx, what are you guys doing about pilotless airplanes? Because planes today fly, 90% or more is flown by computer. So they figured that maybe the first place you're going to see pilotless airplanes would be in non-passenger planes. So they asked the president of FedEx, what's your vision of the future about pilotless planes? And he says, well, we said that in the future our cockpits are going to have a pilot and a dog. So everybody thought, well, why? That's funny, why the dog? He said, the dog is going to be there to bite the pilot if he touches the controls. So it's funny, but it's true. I mean, because that's where we're going. I mean, I know people in the shopping, in the regional mall business. I mean, they're so unsure of their capital future, but the guys that are working on future malls understand they don't need all that parking, but what they need is going to be what they call drop-off points. You're going to need large areas dedicated to autonomous cars coming in and out, dropping people off, picking up people up. That's got to be much more than there now. Yeah.
What do you think the effect in South Florida is for the Brightline train, and then now with Trump administration coming in and kind of, you know, with the isolation policy, bringing back factories and, like you said, warehousing is and industrial should hopefully. I mean, it's been picking up probably because of Panama Canal, especially in South Florida.
Right.
But in the future with Trump administration.
Well, two great questions. Let's talk about the Bright Line, okay. All aboard Florida. It's a great vision. I happen to know the company behind it. It's Fortress. They've been very, very successful. They probably got over $10 billion invested in assets. And they bought the structure of the Florida East Coast Railroad a number of years ago. And when they bought that, they bought all those right-of-ways. And so they created this idea of what can we do to embellish and enhance our land along our right-of-way tracks. In other words, we call that transit-oriented development, TOD. You'll get to that sometime. If you didn't get to it yet, you will. So TOD is a big, big thing in the country right now. Let's get people out of their cars and let's get them living near and working near train stations. So they had this great vision of how they were going to embellish their land. So they said, well, why don't we go into the railroad business? And we'll create the transportation, and the people will want to live or work in the buildings. And so I think that might work to a small degree in downtown Miami and downtown Fort Lauderdale and Palm Beach, because they're going to build a big station. I don't know if you've seen them. I mean, the station in Miami is humongous. So they don't own that much more land around that station. So let me just say that in the United States, there is not one transit system that isn't subsidized by taxpayers, not one. Whether it's bus or whether it's light rail, whether it's trains, taxpayers subsidize it. These guys are going to spend a lot of money getting this thing up and running. If this thing doesn't embellish their land, I can very easily see this whole system 5-10 years from now, going back to the public in some basis or something. As far as Trump and where he's going, the thing I think was so good about him, and this has nothing to do with politics, is that he has created, at least in the short term, excitement, wake up, new energy, because we really became, I don't know what the word is, I mean, just mediocre in everything. And so he wants to tear it all up and throw it all away and bring, you know, revitalization. Will all these jobs really matter? I don't know. You know, I mean, because when you make the automobile, if GM brings back, or Ford brings back making the car in the United States, 50% of the parts are still going to be made overseas. I mean, it's just the assembly that's going to be done here. But the transmissions are made in Hungary, or, you know, and this there, you know, so I don't know how much that's going to change. But I see it as a very hopeful thing. That, by the way, going back to that for a moment, somebody said, well, what can we do with all the shopping centers we're taking back? Well, some brighter person than me said to me, I was talking to last week, said, wouldn't that be a great place to start moving all the new 3D printers we're going to need? Because we're going to need huge buildings to hold all these 3D printers. And so that might be a very logical thing to turn over. The problem with the shopping centers is that the parking garages are of no value because they're all slanted floors. And you really can't create any kind of business. And low ceilings.
Tear down, sir.
Yeah. The most expensive thing to build in a shopping center is the garage, and that's probably going to be the thing that gets torn down. Can you raise your hand? Okay. But your challenge is going to be, because you're coming right into the industry now, what are we going to do with these hundreds of malls? Right now we've converted some of them to churches, schools, a bunch of things, but eventually we're going to run out of things to do.
Build affordable housing.
Maybe we can figure out how to make housing in there somewhere or another. But you mentioned something before about regulators.
That's a regulatory body.
Well, they're going to be the stumbling block.
Mm-hmm. Because they can't keep up with...
They're most bureaucrats are lost in the past. You go into the planning department of Miami-Dade County or Broward County or the city of Plantation or anything, those planning people are archaic. They have bulletproof jobs. They're not going to rock the boat. You say, look, you got to change your building ordinances. You got to change. We can't build it that way anymore. We're going to build it this way. Well, you know, this is what we got. You know, we'll have to have hearings, and we'll have to have public hearings, and we'll have to have the commissioners. So the politicians will start looking like, should we change these rules? We will always be kicking them in the butt to move them along to keep up with us because they don't want to make change. The government just doesn't want to make change. And so, yeah.
Are there any cities in North that's forward thinking in the way here?
Yeah, across the country there are. Yeah,
Dallas.
Houston, Salt Lake City, Raleigh. Nashville, yeah, and in Florida, Orlando, Jacksonville, a lot of great things going on. Okay, that it?
Thank you. All right, you guys can go ahead and continue working on the quizzes there. We'll deal with those here in a few minutes.
When I was your age, we didn't have calculators. Who'd have got?
Had slide rules.
When they invented the first hand calculator, it was in the early 60s. All it did was add, multiply, and divide. That's all right.
Hey, why don't you give me a cap and the other one you did?
Oh, here it is. Good luck to all of you.
Thank you. Good luck on the surgery.